worried, honey.
Oh, and just like your full self. Or like, I don't know, like how vibing. Like just being Joey, just being like, man. And I was too far. I was like, Joey.
Anyway.
Oh. I just appreciate seeing you being you.
Yeah, that's so fun.
In the wild. You know what I mean? I felt like I was watching something in the wild.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, very well. Yes. Bring a larger one to our pew. Yes.
Wait, is it even on? Oh, that's right.
Give today.
For Susan LeBart.
Okay, but I don't know who that is.
Here we go. Yeah. Hi. Good morning. Before the service begins, we share our announcements about things that are going on in our congregation and in our congregational life. I would like to remind everybody that we do have a Teze service this Tuesday at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. We are inviting everyone from our community and this church to come. Are there any further... I feel like you're talking to me specifically. Are there any further, are there any announcements from the congregation?
I have one.
Oh, okay.
We have a very special birthday up here in the choir loft. Selena's birthday was yesterday.
Susan Riley. After church next Sunday during coffee hour, there will be a reception for the fiber arts artists whose work is in the parish house. Join us.
Just want to make sure you... Whoop. Okay. Just want to make sure you all know about an event called Bach to Bach. This afternoon at 1:30 at Christ Church. It's their 8th annual organ marathon. It's free admission. Donations will go to the organ repair fund. I hope to see some of you there. It's a wonderful, wonderful program.
Ramin? Hi, I'm Rich Tobin from the Justice and Action Ministry. And happy Paddy's Day. Today we are collecting for the One Great Hour of Sharing, a special offering of the UCC. Envelopes are available as you came in. And please make out your check to Old Meeting House and write in the memo OGHS. And then just place your envelopes in the collecting basket. Your gifts will allow the UCC and our international partners to provide clean water, food, education, health care, emergency relief, and refugee support and resettlement. One Great Hour of Sharing is a tremendously efficient charity. Ramin has vetted them and their activity, and 95% of their donations go directly to aid those in need, both domestically and worldwide. Please give generously to this very worthy cause.
And on that, I've got more envelopes, and you don't need a check today. Oh my gosh, hi. You don't need to fill it today and hand it in today. On the back, there's the website where we can find the address, and you can mail it if you'd like. So if you raise your hand, I'll just non-discreetly walk over and hand you an envelope.
If there's anything Joey is known for, it's non-discretion. Discretion. Ken.
Normally Wood Stove meets today, but we have the Climate Action Committee meeting right after coffee hour or very shortly after church, so we will meet next week instead.
Excellent. Susie.
Good morning, friends. I'm speaking for the village of Woodbury. This Saturday, we are having our pie breakfast, where if you pay, I think, $8, you can all you can eat. And there's going to be a lot of pies there. But I wanted to say I'm here to support anybody who understands math. Every time I say I taught math, people, I think they're going to throw up. But math, you know, 3.14 is supposed to be pi. Well, it's not pi, because pi is not a number. It's a ratio of the measurements of lengths, which are never accurate, so you can't have a number and a ratio the same. As a math teacher, I haven't done this for 15 or 20 years, but I'm doing it now anyway. come to the pie breakfast to support the library, all funds for the library. It's in Woodbury School, by the way. Thank you.
Thanks, and I'll be sure to have exactly 3.14 slices of pie on that. Any further announcements from the congregation? Tim.
Tim Noonan, Justice in Action, a lot of Justice in Action today. We didn't mean to confuse you by having One Great Hour of Sharon and pins at the same time, but it played out that way. So the deadline for pins, the bulletin, back of the bulletin has all the details about how you can get them to me. People have been handing to me today and will continue to. Next Sunday is the final day to make a pins contribution. And I would just say it was really hard this week to watch the homeless situation and how it's being handled. And I just think it's an illustration. This is just not ending. And so the things we do for pins, One Great Hour for Sharing Forever, we've just got, it's a real critical time. And it's not going away anytime soon. So I know it gets a little fatiguing probably to pay attention to it. But anyway, I just wanted to make that announcement about where we are these days in Vermont and in society in general. So.
Thanks, Tim, and thanks for all the great work that Justice in Action does.
One more?
Oh, there, Nancy, sorry.
I know it's already been mentioned, but Nancy Thomas, also Justice in Action, and we will be having our next conversations after this morning. Right after church, grab coffee and something to eat, and we'll be meeting upstairs in the nursery for that climate conversation. So please join us.
Thank you. If there are no further announcements, I invite you to listen to our prelude, which is done by June and our own Pastor Emerita, David Connor.
A little bit of Irish nationalism. We were immigrants. When Irish eyes are smiling, I'm sure it is like a morning spring in the lilt of Irish laughter. You can hear the angels sing when Irish hearts are happy. All the world seems bright and gay. But when Irish eyes are smiling, sure they'll steal your heart away.
I love that. Good morning, my beloved. I greet you, my family, with the love of Christ. On behalf of our community, I would like to welcome all of you, whether you are here in person or joining us online, to the Old Meeting House. The Old Meeting House is an inclusive community that has welcomed and loved all and celebrates your uniqueness in this sacred place. We hope that in the time we share together that you find yourself surrounded in God's loving embrace. We pray that you're open to receive her blessing, and we pray that God's blessing of unconditional love inspires you to become the person you were created to be. And now let us enter into a moment of silence as we prepare ourselves for worship.
If you'll please read responsively with me. Sisters and brothers, siblings in Christ, come let us walk in love and light.
Come, listen to the voice that calls to us from beyond the stars.
Come, you who yearn for a land where peace, justice, and compassion reign.
Come. Let us fill the world where all men love and men love.
Come, you who seek freedom, equality, and hope.
Come and feel the love of God as we worship together.
Our sister, Octavia Butler, has written, "All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change. Kindness eases change. Love quiets fear. Lord, in our vulnerability, we ask you to fill us with your grace, that we might hear today what your scripture is telling us, and find the courage to summon the changes in ourselves and in our world that reflect your loving care. Amen." The opening hymn is "Be Still My Soul," number 488 in the hymnal.
Thank you.
Please remain standing and turning your hymnals to page 657 as we do our responsive reading with a refrain. The way this works is that we will sing the refrain first after June plays it, and then wherever you see an R after verse 5, after verse 9, and then we conclude at verse 12, not 13, we will sing that refrain again. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgression and my sin is ever before me.
Against you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence, and blameless when you pass judgment.
Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner, when my mother conceived me. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I will be purer than snow. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Seated.
The First Testament reading is from Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 to 34. Hear what the scripture may be saying to you. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Thus ends the reading.
I invite you to share your prayers, joys, and concerns with the congregation. Would anyone like to share a prayer, joy, and concern? Hey, Mary.
Just a big shout of gratitude to the congregation for praying for our children, Glenn and George. They had their first week at Twinfield this week, and it just couldn't have gone better. So thank you for your prayers.
I'm glad it went well. Well, Jay, nice to see you.
Thank you. I just want to say thanks to all of you for all of your support. Rides, meals, sleepovers, and incredible friendship. We have a long ways to go, but we'll get there.
Thank you, Jay. We're so happy that Priscilla's back home with you, and it was nice to take a walk with her, and I was a little stressed out to know that she could actually climb these hills faster than me, given her condition. Any other prayers, joys, and concerns from the congregation? Rona.
Just prayers for my friends, Ann and Peter, who are adjusting to the realities of Peter's recent diagnosis of Parkinson's disease.
Journey through Parkinson's disease and his wife as a caretaker. Thank you. Nancy.
Prayers for Susan and Susan Haywood and her husband, which is left in my mind now. He's in palliative care up at the hospital. And I haven't heard anything since they started that about 3 days ago. But the whole family's there, and prayers for them. Tim Haywood is the sick one.
Let us pray for the Haywood family in their time of need. Hey, Deb.
I just want to just acknowledge what a fabulous time that Carol and I had in New Zealand celebrating Alyssa and Petey's wedding and being with family and touring that spectacular country. It was such a blessing for the two of us. And Patsy had a really wonderful time here with my sister Kathy, who really appreciated the warmth of welcome of this community and just her whole time here in Vermont. So it feels wonderful to be back.
Mom, it makes Mama pictures.
Yes, Patsy's going to go see her friends, the McIntyres tomorrow.
Oh, okay. Welcome home, Deb. We've missed you. Julie.
I'd like prayers for my friend Bob and his mom, Jerry, and brothers Bill and Andrew, as they get used to the idea of Bob's diagnosis with stage 4 lung cancer.
We'll be praying for Bob and his loved ones as he goes through his cancer journey. Thank you. Susan.
I'd like prayers for my brother-in-law and sister-in-law, Jay and Carol, as Carol's Alzheimer's has progressed to the point that she's not able to participate fully in the our joint college reunion that's coming up in a couple of months, hoping that we can get together briefly. Hard.
Let's pray for your friends. We're going through their Alzheimer's.
I've been watching the snow fog with the moisture living off the ground, and hope you'll join me in praying that our spirits are also lifting. It's been a really hard winter. Things are tough all over, but think of that fog and the lifting of spirits.
Thank you, Anne. If there's nothing further from the congregation, I invite you to join me in a moment of silence before I pray, and then we will go enter together into the prayer, the Lord's Prayer. Please join me in a moment of silence. Eternal God, the seasons are changing. The rain is falling, the roads are slippery, and it feels sometimes as if our hearts are just too heavy. And yet in this time, we come together to celebrate our spirits being lifted with the fog lifting itself. The gift of life and love and our community, and the knowledge that knowing that behind the gray skies there is a sun that shines and will shine on us one day. Thank you for all the amazing things that happen in this season. Yes, it is dreary. Yes, it is tough. But there is still so much beauty emerging from this earth and within our hearts. And with that, God, we are grateful. We are grateful to experience our weaknesses and vulnerabilities together, and also our love and the light you bring. And now we ask that you allow us to come to prayer silently as we share our own personal thoughts and concerns. And now let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray when he said, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward as we take up our offering, or as I like to refer to it as our giving moment. This is a time in the life of our church we give back for all that God has done for us. We ask that you give your time, your talent, your treasure, but most of all, we ask that you give a love, your love that has sustained this church for 200 years and will sustain it for 200 more. Amen. Eternal God, our Mother and Father, we come before you with our gifts, our time, our talent, our treasure, but mostly our love. Our love that you have given to us that we share back with this world. We ask that you bless it and sanctify it and make it acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing and let us sing our hymn of preparation, hymn number 288, Let It Breathe on Me.
Breathe on me, let it breathe on me, let it breathe on me, let it breathe on me.
You may be seated.
The New Testament reading is from John chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now, my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. Thus ends the reading.
Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason I have come to this hour. you pray with me, please? Play with me one more time, always. Gracious and everlasting God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. This past Friday, I went for a walk around Sodom Pond with a church member and a friend. This walk around Sodom Pond, along with Hubbard Park, had become my two favorite things to do when I want to clear my head or spend time with people. As we walked, I was reminded of a quote often attributed to A.A. Milne. Sometimes I sits and thinks, and sometimes I just sits. Like Milne, sometimes I walk and think. Other times, I just walk. On Friday, I did a little bit of both. Even though the skies were gray and the roads unforgiving, you could still feel and sense a change in their weather. Between conversations, we observed Canadian and snow geese feeding on seeds and corn near Sibley Farm. We watched and heard industrial trucks rumble by, carrying manure from the barns to the field. The sharp, pungent smell overpowered my senses, but I recognized that we need the manure to bring our fields to life. Occasionally, pickup trucks wobbled past with sap barrels in tow. Every now and then, the perfume scent of maple syrup piping out of Templeton's farm sugar shack would find its way to us. I love these contrasting images of trucks carrying manure and sap. I inwardly smile as I observe their four-wheel jiggle-hop dance and slide as they made their way down those slick roads. It's probably not that different than how we looked as we navigated our way through this unsteady yet familiar path in our offbeat rhythm. I love East Montpelier. Love it. Because it always finds a way to quiet my unquiet mind and nourish my soul no matter what the weather or season. Yeah, winter may not be over, and the reality of climate change has hit our communities hard. But spring will be here soon, and with it, an outburst of light and life and green light. There is something about mud season in central Vermont that evokes bittersweet emotions. Over the course of 24 hours, we can experience the cold apathy of a sub-zero day, followed by a spring-like exuberance in the air. These contrasting images often play on our emotions and mental wellness because it reminds us of life's impermanence, our vulnerability, and the uncomfortable feeling that this period of bitter sweetness, the phrase is Sulika Jawad's, is inescapable. But that is the crux of life's problems, isn't it? To transform our weaknesses and vulnerabilities so that we can anticipate spring during winter, find beauty among the unsightly, light outside of darkness, love where there is apathy, and life beyond death. In between it all, we dance our way along the unsteady yet familiar ground, trying to find meaning and connection in an increasingly complex world. And while this is a universal quest, there is something about acknowledging our vulnerability that speaks to our Lenten journey and unbecoming, letting go of what and who you are in order to realize all that you can be. The focus of my sermon today is on vulnerability. Specifically, I want to explore how God identifies with humankind in our vulnerability. Using parallels and binary themes of darkness and light, death and life, John directs our Lenten journey into another incantatory phase, one where we learn how to transform our vulnerability. Inherent in my exploration is the assumption that most, if not all of us, are feeling vulnerable in some way or another. I recognize this may be presumptuous, but as a former risk manager and one that studies current events, it is safe to assume that with the growing threats to world peace, human rights, job security, as well as threats to our democratic norms, then layer in climate change and wealth disparity, we are all feeling vulnerable. If not, I honestly don't know what more has to happen to make a person feel vulnerable. Guiding my exploration is the following question. How does our vulnerability bring us closer to God and one another? Central to this question is my thesis that acknowledging and naming our vulnerability helps us navigate the turbulent path toward creative healing. In our healing, we recognize ways to unbecome. In our unbecoming, we experience Christ's incantatory love. Through love, we find unity, common cause, and meaning. in a world crying out for peace, eco-justice, and egalitarianism. So with that, let's turn to our text. Our gospel reading from John is really two separate stories linked together by a confession. The first story takes place in Jerusalem, but the location isn't as important as the history behind our gospel, our text, the cast of characters in it, and the dialogue around the parable. If you recall from last week, this gospel was written after the martyrdom of every apostle except John, a decade or two after the Second Temple's destruction and the scattering of Christians throughout the Roman Empire. It is against this backdrop that John, looking back on his life, his episodic quest to find love and light while living in darkness and despair, sat down to record this gospel narrative. His gospel story is demarcated into two distinct books, the Book of Signs and the Book of Glory. Our scripture reading sits on the cusp of these two books. In our first section, John tells a story that foreshadows his passion narrative. Key to this story is not only the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, but also the servant model of discipleship, what it means and who can claim it. Just like in the Synoptic Gospels, serving Christ means addressing the suffering human condition and meeting the unmet needs of those who dwell on the underside of history. As Jesus shares the wheat grain parable, notice the presence of Philip and Andrew, two Jewish, Greek-named, Greek-speaking apostles who brought Gentiles into their movement. I invite you to draw your own conclusions on what the implications of this were back then and are for us today. For me, I am reminded that divine truths, whether from Christ or secular humanist, flourish whenever and wherever there is openness and inclusivity within a faith community. Attached to this story is a scene that closes out the first part of John's gospel, the Book of Signs. In this scene, John shares his Christology and how the ultimate identification of God with humankind is to walk among us, identify with our weaknesses and vulnerabilities, and serve humankind and our planet so too, like Jesus, we can find ways to transform darkness and despair into light and love. Nestled between these two stories is one of the most powerful verses in all of John's gospel, if not the Bible. Now, my soul is troubled. Just like the two-word sentence you can find in chapter 11, Jesus wept, this verse reverberates beyond its scriptural walls and echoes deep within your soul. What makes this sentence so powerful is that it is through Christ's vulnerability that we witness the humanity and divinity of Jesus standing not in contradiction with one another, but in a mystical union. Perhaps another way to read this is that it's through our own weakness and vulnerabilities that we find interconnection to God and humankind, light and love. My point is this: being honest about vulnerabilities, our own vulnerabilities, is important for our Lenten journey as we continue to incantate and navigate our way out of darkness into light and from death to life. In the week ahead and during Holy Week, I want to encourage you to acknowledge and name your vulnerabilities. Open yourself up to new forms love can take and allow that love to lead you further into God's light and life. I want to close this sermon by sharing what I've learned since this Lenten journey began. Last week, I shared the importance of letting go so that God's light can find you. This week, I want to encourage you to embrace your vulnerabilities, your weaknesses, acknowledge and name them, and then let Christ's transformative love heal and nourish you. I kind of experienced what this means while in Houston 2 weeks ago. I was sitting on the couch with my wife when she noticed my furrowed brow, and in her sing-song voice that I love, asked me a question. What are you thinking about? Like A.A. Milne, I told her, sometimes I sit and think, and sometimes I just sit. She gave me a weird look, so I knew that I had to answer again. So I said, I was thinking about the bittersweetness of living in two different states. I told her my heart is heavy and my soul is tired, because no matter where I am, people I love and care about are left behind. As I thought about this a little more carefully, I also told her, I'm tired. I'm tired of carrying this burden wherever I go all my life. And yet, as I spoke these words, I felt a weight lifted off my shoulders. Noticing this, Esther gave me a knowing glance and that little head nudge she does. And so I said to her, I just realized that I have family, friends, and a faith community that loves me, no matter where I go, no matter who I am, or where I am. And I experience Christ's incantatory love amid the bittersweetness of life. Well, as my sermon comes to an end, I want to express my gratitude to all of you, not for me, but for making this place a sacred place where people can find love, community, and meaning when they feel weak, alone, and without purpose. Thank you for being a family to each other, for the friendships forged in common cause, and for being a faith community that invites, welcomes, and values everyone. May we continue to grow stronger in our faith and love for one another this Lenten season, and let us dance down life's beautiful and unsteady roads together. Amen. Before we sing our final hymn, I invite you again to enter a moment of silence. You are invited to stand in body and spirit as we sing our final hymn, I've Got Peace Like a River, hymn number 478.
It's okay. I'd like to offer you a blessing today, only slightly modified from a poem attributed to St. Patrick in the 5th century, which you may recognize as part of St. Patrick's breastplate. Arise today, through God's strength to pilot you,
God's might to uphold you, God's wisdom to guide you, God's eye to look before you, God's ear to hear you, God's word to speak for you, God's hand to guard you, God's way to lie before you, God's shield to protect you. Amen.